Good afternoon and welcome to Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition. What a big show. We have Hawk star Paul Pioppolo is going to be in the building. Cam Guthrie, he's going to bring his brother in. The winning Vic Metro captain, Andrew McGrath. Mohammed Saad, he's the brother of Adam and can kick a goal. And Carlton's new women's coach, Damien Keeping. What a big, big man he's going to be. I'm going to stand next to him and see how big he is because I saw him in the paper next to Brendan Bolton. I'm sure he can't be that big as we work our way around the panel. And first of all, I'd like to welcome Fidel Castro in when he's in his smoker's jacket. Shifter, how are you?
I'm very, very good. I'm just back from the AFL's Field of Dreams up there on the Gold Coast, the under-16 championships. So we're going to chat about the eye catchers and the MVPs a little bit later on the show.
And a man very, very fresh signing autographs after his edition of Open Mic during the week, Terry Wallace.
Hello, Brownie. How are you going? Well, Future Stars are going to have a look at an under-23 future All-Australian side today.
And once upon a time, you did wear the headband. You thought you were the sex symbol of the AFL, VFL back then, but this man, he is the real deal. Alex Rance, the best-looking AFL player in the competition right now, the best centre-halfback. He's in the All-Australian team, and he's here on Future Stars today.
Brownie, great to see you. Feels like a bit of old times here.
Absolutely. Yeah.
They were great times, though, were they, back then? Down the bottom of the ladder a bit.
Change rooms were good times, though.
You like to do your own work. I mean, you are very active on social media. And when you were in here a couple of weeks ago, you took a selfie. Now, have you said, look at this, just you get yourself in there, don't you?
Yeah, usually I do my best work behind the camera, but I thought I'd put myself in there for one.
Let's start on last night's game. And it was not a completely different Richmond last night, but your tackle pressure, your intensity was unbelievable. They haven't lost the contested footy yet this year, but last night playing the young kids, it really did something.
Yeah, it was one of those bittersweet games, you know. You don't get the victory, but you focus on the process. And the contested and tackle work that our mids did was really, really impressive. There's a couple of cough-ups and things that we can tighten up, but our offensive polish was probably one thing up forward that we just didn't quite get right.
Jakey Stringer's a great player in the competition. We know with defence these days that it's a rotation. I know Grimesy played on him for a lot of the game, but what's he like when you actually come up against him?
Yeah, he's one of those players which looks disinterested, and then because of his explosive power, he just can really put a metre or two on you. He's a super talent, and I guess the key to their forward line is that, like you said, they're moving around and you're unable to lock onto one matchup, and you have to be able to exchange between opponents.
Good to have Alex Rance on Future Stars today. What a star he has become. All Australian player. Shifter, what was the big story in the TAC Cup yesterday?
Well, the Stars are back to play after the Nationals, most back playing now, and of course Hugh McCluggage, one that's been talked about as a possible number one, was a star in the Rebels win. He kicked the three goals, he would have had it plenty of times again. Mo Saad, we'll have him on the show a little bit later, kicked a couple of goals in the best for Calder in their win, and there was a fantastic game between Dandenong and Oakley. We'll go into that a little bit later. 40 points down at three-quarter time, you don't expect to get up, so tell a story of that.
And
that was the Brayshaws. Names. The Brayshaws, another couple to come. Angus's brothers, of course, there at Sandy, kicked six goals between them. And it was Hamish that kicked four in the third quarter that got his side really rattling. And then Andrew chipped in with a couple of goals. So six between them in Sandy's impressive win. We see a little bit of him in action.
And a young man that I played a lot of football with was Scott Wessel. He's an old man. His young kid at the moment is just belting down the door in a Jack Viney type of atmosphere.
Yes, and you've got Riley West we're talking about, and he was the MVP for Vic Metro in the National Under-16s. We see a little bit of him action. No surprise he's a tough in and under player. He's got great hands and visions. He sets the play up with the way he uses his hand passing in particular, kicks the ball long, played in the midfield. And he, along with some other father sons, John Blakey's boy, Nick, was very, very impressive. He's playing for New South Wales, and Robert Scott's young fella, Bailey, the best and fairest player, or the most valuable player for Queensland, as we look at these names. They'll be names of the future, these boys. We're a wrap with a standard of play. This Ian Hill boy is his own highlight, really. He's related to Brad and Stephen, and he has got so many tricks. He's a work in the air and his speed, unbelievable.
Nick Blakey's got a big decision plough, hasn't he? Because I think there's a couple of father-son options he could take.
Absolutely, and it's always fascinating because we've seen in the past that Mark Murphy didn't necessarily go to where his dad played, so that'll be interesting to see how it plays out.
What are the options for him? Because if I was Sydney, I'd be trying to sign John Blakey's old man up for a long-term contract now so they can get him, because I heard he's probably top three, even top maybe around top five.
Well, there's actually three options that he could go to, obviously the North Melbourne and the Lions option as well, so that'll be fascinating to see how that plays out. we just talk about those young boys when they're coming through and how they're going. One man who played like that when he was coming through the junior ranks is Tom Mitchell. He's got an interesting challenge on his hand now about what he's actually going to do, because I get the sense, boys, that there's a big contract awaiting for him if he wants to come back to Victoria.
Rancy, you'd love a player like him at your footy club?
Absolutely, super talented. You've seen he's racked up, I think, 50 touches in the kneeful in a couple of games, and real ball magnet, strong contested player, and I'm sure that a lot of Victorian clubs will certainly be putting their bids forward for him.
Well, you just wonder, with obviously the signing of Buddy and Kurt Tippett, whether they've got enough money from a TPP point of view. Probably 12 months ago, he wouldn't have commanded huge money, but now there'll be clubs coming after
him. But wasn't he on a pretty good contract already? So I think he is pretty well played up there. I know Richmond have tried to get a few players. They tried to get Dan Hennaby last year, and there was a player who had most of the summer off just figuring out whether he wanted to play. What about your end of season this year, Rancy? I mean, if it's a rebuild at Richmond, are you part of that rebuild?
Well, I'm not sure that the words rebuild have been thrown around too much at the football club, but yeah, we'll be going over to Europe and seeing a bit of the
extended
European
holiday like last time.
It'll be long-ish. so I'll spend about 6 weeks over in Europe and checking out Russia and Iceland and things like that. Ooh. Something a bit different.
Iceland went very well in the soccer, didn't they?
Yeah, they did.
What interests you about Russia and Iceland?
I heard the vodka's quite good in Russia, so I might head over there for that and check out that. But just something completely off the map, somewhere that's not the usual tourist attraction. I'm interested in those type of things.
Now, Alex, a multicultural round, of course, and Richmond played their part with Oleg Markov making his debut. Speaks fluent Russian and, of course, was impressive, wasn't he, last night?
Yeah, Russian-born. His dad was an Olympic pole vaulter. And he was a very talented gymnast himself. He's actually, a fun fact about him, he built a motorbike from scrap metal and got it roadworthy. So he is...
That's a handy man, isn't it?
He's a very, very handy man. And he reads the game really well. He seems to be a natural backman, and he's got really, really good speed to close it down and reads it really well.
Talk us about your hands-on approach. Would you be able to build a motorcycle, Alex?
I don't think so. I'll be able to push one.
What you have put together, though, is an academy. Talk us through your academy.
Well, yeah, it's for year 11 and 12 students, boys and girls, and it's really built around three key pillars. So we've got personal, which really talks about the best learning styles for yourself, resilience, giving and receiving feedback, also the educational component, because we never stop learning, so it's more about the life skills, money management, body and life management, and finally the athletic component, where it'll put you in the best technical position and for you to be durable as soon as you reach that AFL level. So it's by no means a daycare centre. You will go there to learn, and we've spent a lot of time and hours building this curriculum so that it can benefit these boys and girls.
Great stuff.
There's some exciting players in the AFL. Lance Franklin, you've got Dustin Martin, Paddy Dangerfield, but over here at the McCaffrey stand, Paul Pioppolo, welcome to Future Stars, mate. I mean, you are one of the most exciting players in the competition. How does that sit with you?
No, I don't think of myself like that. I just have to play the role on the side. I guess we all got roles in our side, and mine's putting that pressure on, and obviously now taking some contested marks and give me a bit of a license to have a jump, so can't obviously do too many, but yeah, definitely put my
we'll get to the jumping in a minute, and it is fantastic, but there's a buzz every time you go near the footy. I mean, there's very few players that everybody gets excited about. I think you're universally loved, and that must make you feel good as a player who hasn't played a lot of football at the moment, but every time you go near the ball, there's a buzz. I was on the couch watching that game the other night, and I was excited when you went near the footy.
So I guess it's something I've probably built on. I guess I wasn't known for that as I first came into that in the AFL, but I'm getting a little bit more confidence now, and you know, just having that the people around me that are giving me the confidence. We've got some great players around us, and they're just happy to play in that role for that side.
Now, you're a South Australian boy, and one of my favourite players growing up was Tony Modra and also Mark Ricciuto. We've got a photo here of you as a young man with the great man Mods and Roo there. Talk us through this one. This is fantastic.
Definitely. I grew up in Adelaide, and you know, had the opportunity to have a photo with those guys, and I really looked up to a guy like Mark Ricciuto, obviously with an Italian background. You know, my parents obviously loved him because of the Italian background, but yeah, no, they had that moment with those guys. Yeah, it was very special, and obviously Modra has always taken his hangers, so yeah.
That's where you got the itch from, isn't it? Watching Tony Modra as a youngster.
A little bit, yeah, definitely. But Pioppolo's a little bit harder to yell out than Modra. I don't doesn't sound as
Bruce
good.
Bruce McAvaney loves rubbing it out. Yelling your name out, though, when he takes a mark.
Yeah, he does. He does a pretty good job at it, too, so he makes it sound pretty special.
Well, Mods did take a lot of marks, and you took another one Thursday night. Have a look at this one. This was a belter. This has got me off the couch the other night. Talk us through it.
I knew Lewis was going to pass it. It's sort of a team thing to do that kind of stuff, and just saw the opportunity to run and have a jump at it. But I got a little bit worried when I started to turn in the air because I thought I was going to land on my head, but luckily I managed to land on the side of my body.
Well, you've made an art form of it this year, and you've made an art form of kicking goals at the right time too. So I've picked out my five favourite marks of the last couple of years. This is the first one versus Adelaide. This is this year, earlier on in the year. You went back, kicked a big goal. This one, talk us through this one. This is one of my favourites.
Saw the opportunity. I had to go. There was no one else in the contest, and I just happened to hold on to it.
This one against Collingwood's very Michael Roach from the 80s. This one is a belter too. This is huge. That is huge. Huge moment. Easter Monday. That is a big grab.
Yeah, definitely. The crowd erupted over that. But I get a bit nervous after taking a mark because you always have to go back and kick the goal because it's not as special if you don't kick the goal. So a little bit of pressure.
And that last one, that number one, that one over Boonie Vince, I think it was, that you sort of hung there for a while. It was beautiful. We had Jeremy Howe on the show before the Sunday Footy Show, but have you won Mark of the Year yet?
No.
You've got to win it this year. You get the card. That'd be fantastic.
Definitely, but yeah.
And the Hawks, premiership bound again. I mean, you haven't been playing great football, but you find yourselves clear on top of the ladder.
Yeah, we managed to win a lot of close games where we could have gone either way. So for that, it just gives us that benefit of now, when we come to the end of the year, that we've got those matches behind us and gives us a bit of breathing space between the other sides. So obviously we've got to keep building for finals and hopefully we can play good footy at the right time.
We're here for the multicultural round. You're going to join us on the panel in a minute, but don't forget to try McCafe's finest barista-made coffee ever at McCafe or McCafe Drive. So we've got a heap more to come, but Shanae, who's going to make you a coffee, stand here for a couple of minutes while we get back over here. She's going to make you a coffee. She is going overseas in the World Skate Championships later on this year. In Huntington, fantastic work from McCafe, and she's going to be teaching you how to make those coffees. Right. So still plenty more to come on Future Stars for INC Sports Nutrition.
Still to come on Future Stars, more with Hawks star Paul Puopolo as he tells us why the Hawks small forwards are so good. Plus, we're joined by Cats gun Cam Guthrie and his younger brother Zach from the Calder Cannons. Plough unveils his under-23 All-Australian team, plus the new coach of the Carlton women's team joins us live on the panel. It's a jam-packed show, so stick around for plenty more right here on Future Star.
Hawthorne的进攻，好球，这又是波波罗吧？哦，这是Rioli。这叫Specky。传，利用长传找机会。 霍森的定球确实非常厉害，这是西西里，西西里拿球之后直接射门，这个球进了，会，但是没有选择射门而选择了传球，漂亮，波波罗一个 specky 就是，哦，什么？Some
fantastic work by the Mandarin commentary team on Thursday night for the multicultural round. We've got Paul Puopolo on the show, and it's good to see that in any language, a specky is still a specky, isn't it?
Definitely great. Yeah, that's great that the AFL have brought that in so all different cultures can listen in on the game and enjoy it in their own language.
You are part of the Multicultural Ambassador Program, and we've got a photo here of you. There's a lot of you, but it's a good crew to be part of.
Yeah, definitely. It's great to hear some of the stories and where people come from. When we catch up on the launch, you hear all the stories and where the families are from. So it's great to get to know a bit about the other players and other teams. And obviously that opens up doors when you come to your club and people tell their stories.
And Tobin Brothers are a sponsor on this show and a great ambassador for multicultural. Shifter.
Poppy, we just want to pick up your journey because 7 years ago you were driving a digger.
Yeah.
Earth-moving business. You were having cakes for Smoko. Yeah. And trying to get a game at Norwood. You know, that's 7 years ago. What turned it all around to get you on the radar for Hawthorne?
I guess it was, I sort of put work before footy. I went that way where I sort of missed out under 18s. I was pretty disappointed. But just had to change something in my life. And I guess it was more about the diet and, you know, putting footy first. And worked on stuff that I needed to work on.
Have a look at these highlights. You certainly did some bicep curls as well, didn't you?
Yeah, I haven't touched the weight since then. Now, Hawthorne don't want me doing weights. They want me to turn into a little meatball. But, but yeah, definitely stay away from the weights now.
And you played forward and back. Did they approach you, Hawthorne? Like, how did it come to be that you were then chosen?
Yeah, I actually started my journey as a midfielder, but played a little bit in the forward line. And then I went to... they obviously wanted to use my speed as a backman and start driving the ball out of defence because it was an opportunity to, you know, create something for our Norwood Football Club through defence. And, yeah, I just took the game on a little bit, and I think that's where I started to get noticed, is just taking the game on.
Now, Poppy, I see a lot of similarities, and Kingy would probably attest to the fact that I reckon you play a very similar aggressive attacking game style. Do you see him as someone that might have taken after you, or you taken after him?
Definitely, yeah. I remember watching him play. He's definitely one that really went really hard at the footy, and I did get nicknamed the Push-Up King at Norwood, so definitely get named after that. So.
I know Jake King well. There's no way you ever want to be associated with his name. He's a little angry man, and I think you're a very upstanding citizen. But what I want to show is the goal against Adelaide. You took a fantastic mark, but under pressure. Just talk us through this. I mean, diving mark, and this is a big moment.
Yeah, definitely. I had a few boys whisper in my ear. Jordan Lewis didn't give me much confidence. He goes, there's under 30 seconds. You have to kick it. But Sean Burgoyne was a bit more level-headed, and he just said, go back and do a bit of a return. You can see him crouching down there because it was his 300th and he was pretty nervous.
It's quite remarkable now the consequences of that kick and how the ladder would actually be changed if you hadn't kicked it.
Yeah, I definitely didn't think about that. It was more about the result for the game, and obviously the win for Shawnee on his 300 is something you always remember, so it was great to get the win.
Now, Poppy, joining you up on the forward line this year is a rising star in James Sicily. Can he win the award? How good's his year been?
Yeah, definitely. He has some really big games. There's one game against the Western Bulldogs where he pretty much won us the game, and against North Melbourne, who was outstanding. So he can. He's one of the guys that can really read the ball in the air, and He's become a real key feature for our side because you kick along down the line and he's gonna juke him most of the time. He's a great reader of the ball and can pop up.
Body work too. He reads it so well. But definitely then for a small, he's only 187 or 188 for that size. He just uses his body so well, doesn't he?
Yeah, he does, and that's been one of his strengths. But now he's got a little bit of aggression behind him too, and he's getting real confident. So it's great for our side to have young kids coming up and stepping up in that role.
Well, talking about young kids, there are so many great young kids in the competition. Plough's going to have a look at his best under 23 side.
Yeah, well, Brownie, what we decided to do is pick our own future stars, future All-Australian side. I put a couple of criteria in there. You had to be 23 or under by the start of the year, so all the ages that we will see is their age as it stands right at the moment. Also, you couldn't have been selected in an All-Australian side before, so that cuts out the likes of Wingard, Gaff, Stringer, Jeremy Cameron, those sort of blokes. So it's a future All-Australian potential side. We start off from the back line, Rancey. I've tried to balance it out with three tools and three running players from those defensive areas.
I think you can really see the changing of the guard with especially the key position players. The Presta Giacomos don't tend to make the All-Australian teams anymore. Jacob Wiedering, Lever and McGovern have some real aerial power, and I think that they're the real interceptors, and Sam Doherty as well. He's right up there for possession gains. So
they all look like good users too, don't they? Good users out of the back end's a must.
Well, and we're just looking at some vision of Zach Williams. I mean, I would have thought at the start of the year no one would know who Zach Williams was, and just shows how much this group are growing and really developing as players. And you know, his run and carry has been outstanding for the side. We walk onto the mids, and I've tried shifter to pick a midfield structure which has got two genuine wingmen in it as well.
Yeah, and look, Lockie Hunter, isn't he the surprise packet in that group to see him as good as he is? Mark Hunter's son, so he's the third of the father's sons to go to the Bulldogs in a short space of time. Libertores and Wallace's we knew about, but Lockie Hunter's developed into a brilliant player, reads it so well, his footy IQ is so high, and then Brodie Grundy, hasn't he taken off in recent weeks?
And it feels like Luke Parker's 28, 29, he's been around for years. He's only 20, that surprised me when his name came up.
Yeah, just a magnificent group, that lot. When we roll on to the forward structure, again, I tried to balance it off the difference between the mids and small forwards, Paul, and the guys who obviously play the key position. And one of those, you've lost a couple of key position forwards over the period of time. Tommy Lynch would be a very handy inclusion into the Hawk lineup, I would think.
Yeah, definitely a guy, a big, strong forward that can take those grabs and also bring the ball down the ground. You know, he's always going to put his body on the line and bring the ball forward. And same with Jesse Hogan there. He always puts his body on the line and brings it forward.
And just going to the interchange and emergencies, try to get a balance. We've got a lot of running players. Obviously, Lukey Dalhouse, who can play virtually any role within the lineup of the side. Alex, some pretty key names there.
Some pretty stiff individuals there too. A fair few best and fairests in the... and probably Zach Merritt's going to win Essendon's best and fairest this year in the emergencies, but absolutely some talented players. Adam Terrell, Ollie Wines, he's an absolute bull. Yeah, some talent there.
And no doubt whatsoever, just watching some footage of Zach Merritt, I think you're right. I think that his form this year, since he's been given the responsibility to go into the middle of the ground, has been outstanding. Well, we have a look at that's where it sort of stands at the moment with the players from each side that get in there. GWS, obviously.
That's scary, isn't it? Seven players.
It is. But what I've also done for a social media point of view, Brownie, is we've actually picked a squad of players who are unlucky to miss out. And the interesting thing about that is that there's two clubs that are absolutely high on the list, and that is the Western Bulldogs are right up there with GWS. So they look like the two sides that have got the most potential going forward.
Oh, if you want to talk about it, get on social media, give us a belt out, talk about Terry Walsh. Ask Poppy a question, even ask Alex Rance a question. We've got some great superstars coming up. Paul, thanks for joining us on Future Stars, and good luck in your quest for four in a row.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me on.
Getting a bit greedy. There's still plenty more to come after the break. We've got Geelong star Cam Guthrie's brought his brother Zach in, plus Adam Saad, brother of Muhammad Saad. He is going to be in for INC Sports Nutrition. He kicked six earlier on in the year. See you next. Nice work by Sinead over at the McCafe. Well, the Swans got it done on Friday night against the Cats. All the action called in Greek for multicultural round. And one of the Cats who played on Friday night is Cam Guthrie. He joins with his younger brother, Zach, who hoping to get drafted this year. Don't think you're seeing double because he's young. It's a younger version of Cam Guthrie. Welcome to Future Stars. And Cam, wasn't the best night the other night, but the Cats certainly in premiership mould at the moment.
Yeah, it wasn't. I think we've had a couple of weeks where we haven't quite nailed our game plan and stuff like that. So it was a disappointing night on Friday, but hopefully, as you said, we can bounce back and look towards finals.
This is exciting. You bring the brother in, you got the same hair, the mum and the family sitting there watching, hoping you don't say anything silly or anything like that.
I'm enjoying myself.
Yeah, he'll be all right. He'll be all right. He's going all right footy-wise this year, so hopefully continue that.
Where are the Cats at the moment? Because a little bit inconsistent. I mean, you've played some great footy against the Dogs, but then the other night, a team you probably expected to beat down in Geelong, even though they are a great team in Sydney, but you probably, I thought you were off the boil a little bit on Friday night.
Probably a little bit. I don't think you can come into any game expecting to win. It's a very even outfit all over the competition this year, so you definitely got to be on your game, and Sydney probably got the jump on us a little bit, so and then we struggled to make it back.
Now, Cam, Joel Selwood and Patrick Dangerfield, two absolute superstars of the competition, but I'd absolutely put you in the same category as them. You're having a fantastic year this year. What's been the catalyst for you to be able to take that next step to be that consistent player?
Thanks, Ramsey. I guess it's just a combination of a few years now in the system. It's definitely non-stop hard work, so I think I've got that base behind me now, and I don't think I'm quite up to those standards yet, but hopefully I can continue to improve and one day I might be.
Now, they tell me, Cam, that you liked the basketball in the day when you were growing up. Were you a good player?
No, I wasn't very good at all, but myself and Zach, we definitely like watching the NBA, and I think, yeah, there's Zach with Kyrie Irving and myself dressed up at Mad Monday as Uncle Drew, so we definitely tune into the NBA playoffs, and we definitely like, yeah, tuning in.
Zach, do you think the basketball actually helps with your footy a bit?
Yeah, definitely. I think it's definitely translates. I think you see a lot of sort of basketballers these days definitely being sort of clean with the ball, and I think it definitely translates over to footy.
Now, Zach, you didn't just jump on the Cavs bandwagon when LeBron came across, did you? Have you been a Cavs fan for a long time?
Yeah, Kyrie Irving's always been my favourite player, so I've followed him before they got LeBron, and that was definitely a nice bonus when they got LeBron as well.
Fantastic.
Yeah, tell us about growing up in your household there in Sunbury. The Guthrie boys, all footballers. I think we've got a little bit of a pick of the boys getting into it. But just tell us about the influences around family and your love of the game.
Yeah, definitely. It's Zach and myself, and we've got two other brothers. Dad played a bit of footy himself, so we're always around footy and other sports for sure. So we grew up in a pretty competitive household. There's, I think, myself playing my 50th game, so... Yeah, I started playing when I was about 10 and loved it ever since.
And Zach, yourself, you've actually had a growth spurt, some phenomenal growth spurt in the last 3 years. You've grown 25 centimetres just in the last 3 years. You're bigger than this fella. How do you measure up there?
Yeah, no, we're pretty similar in height now. Sort of had a...
You're bigger. I saw you walking, you're big. Yeah. It's okay to say it, he's not going to belt you.
Yeah. I haven't seen him for a couple of weeks and actually scared me standing next to him. He's probably getting a bit bigger than me and it's probably definitely helping his footy as well.
Let's have a look at him playing there at Calder. How have you enjoyed your year, mate? You're really playing well across half-back. You modelled your game on what?
We're definitely starting to put together some good footy now, sort of getting all our sort of private school boys back. I think we've won 5 in a row now, so that's sort of getting towards some better form and stuff. Probably sort of model my game a little bit on Cam. I've watched a lot of him over the years, sort of from junior level and now at AFL level. Enjoy watching him as well.
And you can push into the midfield, do you think, and play other roles?
Yeah, I played probably mostly midfield sort of early on in my career and just sort of enjoying my time down back. So probably just play wherever the coach sort of needs me.
And Cam, we've got a photo of you here winning the Calder BNF. And I think the man next to you is Dion Prestia.
That is Dion Prestia, having a great career himself at the Gold Coast and Jordan Schroeder as well, who had a couple of years with myself at Geelong. So that doesn't feel like that long ago, but it's probably going on 6 or 7 years. So
now, is there any fighting between you two growing up? I know you're competitive, all young kids. I've got two girls who are 5 and 4 and they punch the bejesus out of each other every day. Does that stop as you get older? What would I got to look forward to?
Yeah, a little bit. I think I could always take him, but as I said before, he's getting quite big himself. So, you never know. He might
go to
mix with me.
Cam, thanks very much for coming into Future Stars. Zach, good luck this year. Hope you get drafted. Hope you guys go all the way this year because the Cats are playing fantastic footy. Thanks for coming on Future Stars.
Thanks, Brent. Thanks for having us.
And you win all these prizes. This is the best prize route in the business. Hold with me because this goes for a while. The Chemist Warehouse Gift Lounge for Chemist Warehouse. Real brands and real savings. Take the P-Ball Challenge for Prostate Health. It's a game you've been busting for, available at Chemist Warehouse. $250 Totally Workwear, Australia's largest network of workwear providers. Find your store locally. $50 McCafe voucher. They're fantastic. Head in a drive-thru to taste the finest barista-made coffee ever. A night for two at the Melbourne Parkview Hotel in St Kilda Road. Close to everything that's Melbourne. The all-new HTC 10, the world's first ultra-selfie optical. You can take some selfies of yourself there. Fantastic stuff. Grab a delicious meal with a $100 voucher at Platform 28 down here at the Docklands. Fantastic food down there after a game. 50% off voucher at Sam & Co. Sammy dresses all of us here on Future Stars to get down to see him at 447 Chapel Street. And BioFlow recovery voucher. BioFlow magnetherapy used by many for natural pain relief, recovery and wellness. Absolutely fantastic prize pack. Thanks to all our sponsors. Let's get over to one of our sponsors, the McCafe Stand with Terry Wallace. He's got a famous name to celebrate multicultural around.
Well, we certainly have, Brownie. We've got Mohammed Saad with us, obviously brother of Adam Saad. Mohammed, welcome to the McCafe area.
Thanks for having me.
How have you found your football progressing along, from the junior ranks, obviously now coming into the under-18s?
It's been good so far. Last year, playing first year Tac Cup was a bit in the back line and the forward line, but this year, really enjoy my footy up forward.
Do you find yourself more natural? I mean, you kicked a bag of goals earlier on in the year playing there. How's that been? And do you find yourself more as a natural forward?
Yeah, I do find myself as a natural forward, but I don't mind going down the back, doing a bit of Adam run and carry. But, kicking 7 was pretty good, but it was credit to the midfielders getting it down there.
Now, Adam, obviously coming through the system, I mean, it wasn't easy for him to make it. Some of his experiences, has that helped you sort of coming through the system as well?
It has. Getting overlooked in 2 nationals and 3 nationals and 2 rookies has really, let me really experience it. So he tells me to never give up and he's been really good for my footy.
Now, obviously, you want to make the big league as your brother has done. We know that the Saudi army was out in force when Adam played his first game. How many were actually at the game?
So he got 100 tickets to give out, but he could have given out at least 200, 150, but he's been a bit generous.
So your dad's here as well. Are you expecting the same? Are you expecting dad to roll out the numbers if you get your first game?
If I do get it, I hope so, but wouldn't mind.
Well, you're the Tobin brothers, young multicultural nominee earlier on in the year, and good luck with that award, and good luck for your future, and we hope to see you in the AFL.
Thank you.
Now, Mohammed, when you're kicking 7, don't give too much kudos to the midfielders. They run around, they don't get much ball, they run around on their own. When you kick 7, you've got to take it all, mate.
7 of 9 too, Brownie, mind you.
Fantastic work. Good to see you. I'm sure we're going to see more of Mohammed Saad. From one star to another up after the break, 2016 draft bolter Vic Metro co-captain Andrew McGarr for INC Sports Nutrition. He's up next.
चला नहीं है जीडब्ल्यूएस जायंट्स के लिए इसी बीच जो कश्मकश चल रही है बॉल अभी भी किसी भी तरफ जा सकती है और इसी बीच एक कोशिश है गोल करने की और लगाकर गोल कर दिया कोलवुड ने बहुत ही उम्दा गोल एक
Now, welcome back to Future Stars. Brian C, sports nutrition, INC elite performer. Well, he got the job done. Now, I must say, I've got it in my ear, just got in my ear, that we might have to leave this segment halfway through. Bill Shorten, the opposition leader, is going to hold a press conference. So that's no disrespect for our next guest, because I believe he is more important than Bill Shorten. But we are going to go to Bill Shorten's press conference at some stage. He's the Vic Metro under 18 captain, Andrew McGrath. Welcome, mate. What a championship it was for you, because you are the draft bolter now.
Thanks for having me. Yeah, it was obviously an exciting period over the last few weeks, playing about four games in 20 days. Pretty mentally and physically draining, but I guess the boys around you kind of get you through it, and the coaching staff who put confidence in you every week really made it worthwhile.
And confidence in you to be named as the captain. I mean, they don't just name anybody captain. Captain of the Vic Metro team who wins the championship, that's pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, obviously it was a massive honour to be captain with one of my good mates, Geordie. And yeah, I kind of took it in with my stride and yeah, tried to adapt my game around being captain and looking after other blokes as well as myself. So yeah, it was a really good experience and I really thank all the coaching staff for putting their confidence in me.
Yeah, Eddie, how do you separate that, your individual goals to want to play as well as you can to possibly get drafted and winning as a team, which is all about the team focus. How do you sort of separate those two things?
Yeah, I guess when your team's going as well as we were, the focus around the camp was all winning and all trying to win that national championships, which was in the back of everyone's mind throughout the whole championship. But I guess when you are winning, your team's going pretty well, your individual performance kind of comes along with that. But yeah, I tried not to think too much about my own performance and about everyone watching, I guess, and more so the team focus, because if you do win as a team, individual performances do get highlighted, as you said.
Mm-hmm. Now, Andrew, Mark Blixavs, probably in a similar position to you, was looking to go to the Olympics as a very talented athlete. You were you medaled in the 400 metre hurdles and you did some jumping events. How did you make the decision to potentially be an Australian Olympian versus pursue your AFL dreams?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, obviously it was a pretty big decision for me. I loved footy and athletics growing up. I guess the decision came down to what I liked doing more, and at the time, about 2 years ago, it was football. And my parents always said, just pick whichever one you love. So I stuck with footy. It was pretty hard early on, but I guess now it's kind of paying off and I'm really loving
it. Your mum was a hurdler, wasn't she?
Yeah,
she was. How did she take the news that you were going to go footy?
she was a little bit shocked at first. She doesn't really like the physicality of footy, but yeah, I think she's adapted to it pretty well now. So
now tell us, Andrew, you've got a pretty special relationship with Nick Del Santo, who is often on this panel as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Nick lives on our street and mum and dad usually see him walking around. He always asks how my footy's going. So over the summer we caught up a few times, had a bit of a kick. He taught me a few little pointers, and yeah, it's been really good. It's helped my kicking a lot, and I really appreciate all the work he's done for me.
Yeah, he certainly is a good man, Nicky Dell. Let's get to the Builders Academy Team of the Year. Enrol at Builders Academy Australia and build our future in building construction. Visit buildersacademy.com.au. Andrew McGrath just slips into the back pocket there. Fantastic work, mate.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
What are some of the other names in there? Do you think you maybe in a midfield spot, maybe a wing spot?
No doubt.
Get up the ground a little bit. Nah. This back pocket stuff. I don't pick this team, by the way.
It's I would have the back pocket.
In the midfield.
No, there's nothing wrong with the back pocket. Love it back there. So, yeah, it's going well.
And there we see the ladder just as it stands right at the minute. There's games being played today, but the amazing match yesterday was the Dandenong Stingrays win over the Oakley Chargers. Down by the 40 points at three-quarter time. You don't often get up. They've got up by 1 point.
Big finish.
Oh, Sam Fowler's kicked 3 goals in that last quarter. Josh Battle with a couple of goals. And big Dylan Atkins in the ruck kicked an amazing goal as well. And that's a sensational victory for the Dandenong Stingrays.
Fantastic work. Big 7 goal last quarter. And I've just been told that Bill Shorten said that I'm going to wait until Andrew McGrath's finished his segment, and he said, I'm going to wait. The young man, it's his first time on TV, and congratulations. Thanks for joining us, and good luck for the rest of the season.
No worries. Thank you very much for having me.
It's time now to get to the Tobin Brothers Multicultural Player of the Round. And over the years, Tobin Brothers Funerals has developed experience and expertise in the funeral customs of numerous faiths and cultures and serves a broad spectrum of Melbourne's multicultural community. This week's nomination is Asava Radagolia, the Fijian from the Murray Bush Rangers shifter.
Yeah, and a big centre half forward to be seen playing the Nationals as well. A boy from Cobram up there in country Victoria, but born in Fiji, and wonderful to see him playing so well to be among the best in multicultural round.
Ah, fantastic work. Thanks to Tobin Brothers again. Stick around after the break. We're joined by Carlton's women's coach, Damien Keeping, for INC Sports Nutrition. Welcome back to Future Stars. Not far away, Bill Shorten is going to call a press conference, so we are at the mercy of the gods, but he's wanted to wait for the women's segment, and Roz Lanigan, and you've brought a very special guest in, Roz.
I have. We're joined today by Damien Keeping, the coach of the new Carlton women's side. Thank you for joining us, Damien.
You're very welcome.
Tell us, you're appointed last week. You start full-time in a couple of weeks at the Blues. What has the recruitment process been like? How did you end up at the Blues?
So, back in, if we go back 18 months or so, I was involved with the VWFL Academy, and through that process got an opportunity to coach the Western Bulldogs, and not too long after that first experience back in March, I had some conversations with Carlton, and it's led to them getting a licence, and away we go.
And one of the great photos I saw last week. Now, surely you're not this much bigger than Brendan Bolton. Tell us about this photo. This is a belter.
Well, there is a story that goes with it. When we lined up to take the photo, Brendan was at the back of that group, and the photographer did ask him to come forward. So he took a little while to get up there too, I must say.
How did you get your first coaching gig, as I understand, was as the coach of your son's under-9s team at Gisborne. How do you get from coaching the under-9s at Gisborne to coaching an AFL women's club?
Look, it's been a fairly quick journey. Back at the Gisborne Rookies, just coaching juniors is where it did start. But then some opportunities opened up at the Calder Cannons, and Ian Kite's been incredible in affording me some opportunities through the development programs out there. And this year I was defensive line coach for the Cannons of the TAC Cup under 18 level, and then as I mentioned through VWFL Academy, and I've had some experience through the Vic Metro Youth Girls program too, which has been really, really good for my development, and I think that's really started my interest in female football.
Coaching the Bulldogs against the WA side, it gives you a bit of an idea of what talent is out there. Will you play a major role in actually getting the talent into the football club for Carlton?
Yeah, most definitely. We've already started that process. We've started looking at many, many games across weekends.
You're out this afternoon to watch
a game. Out this afternoon down to St Kilda to watch a game down there. So, look, you know, there's a heap of talent to look at, a lot of work to do in the time that we've got before the draft come October.
What's the difference between coaching female footballers and coaching male footballers?
Look, I don't approach it really differently, in the sense that it's a group of players in front of me that want to get better. And from a coaching point of view, that's how I approach it. Definitely there's some different types of communication that you need to apply to the group. But essentially, when we peel it back, their footballers wanting to get better.
The AFL held its Darwin talent search during the week, and there was an amazing result up there. An army medic by the name of Heather Anderson, who played for the Western Bulldogs last year, smashed the Northern Territory and the AFL female record for the beep test, reaching a huge 14.5, which is just fantastic. Shifter, you can sort of put that in context of how the boys doing that in that beep test.
Well, it's amazing. That's way above the average of the boys. It's about a 14.2 of them. But Alex, what was your best ever?
I don't think I did that well at draft camp. I think I sort of got around that in a few of the trials that I did back in the day. You know, the fish always keeps getting bigger when you tell the story about, 14, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. But that's a pretty amazing effort. There's certainly AFL players that wouldn't be able to reach that standard.
Damien, still awaiting the announcement of the marquee players for each of the 8 AFL women's teams, and you're in that basket as well, but it was revealed during the week that Carlton has signed an in-principle agreement with Brianna Davey, of course, the Matildas, former Matildas soccer goalkeeper. What's the story there, and what's the wait like as a coach? I bet you want to put your team together right now.
I'd be great if I had the team that we could run out and do some training and start to build that side of the program. But look, with Bree, she's a fantastic individual and a wonderful story, you know, coming from the elite level of, with soccer and transferring over to AFL. It is a great story, and I think that that's one of the exciting things moving forward with the whole competition is that we'll get to know these girls really well. We'd love to have someone like Bree at the Carlton Football Club. She'd bring a whole heap on and off the field for us, and we're waiting for that announcement from the AFL.
Well, the majority of the talent for the AFL next year will come from the VFL women's competition. Let's look at the results from yesterday's games. Melbourne Uni, a very, very big win over Diamond Creek. 14 goals there. As you see, Jess Cameron was the only goal kicker for Diamond Creek. Jess Anderson kicked 5, Caitlin Ashmore and Ellie Blackburn 3 each. And Cranbourne having a bit of a shock win over the Western Spurs. And Jacobson, you've coached her before, haven't you?
Bianca's going to be a superstar of the competition, and it's great to see her continuing some great football out of that exhibition game back in June.
And some big games in the VFL Women's today. St Kilda Sharks taking on the Eastern Devils at Peanut Farm Reserve in St Kilda. You're going down to that one, Damien. That's obviously the match of the day here. Seaford taking on Darabin in Seaford, and Knox will host Geelong at Wan Turner.
Yeah, Damien, I wanted to ask about the age profile of the side you're assembling. Are we starting at 18 years of age or younger? What do you expect it to be?
Well, the starting point will be at 18. And certainly in this initial draft, given that there's a current playing group and we're assembling a list from nothing to 25 thereabouts, that'll be about the number of players. It'll be a pretty widespread age spread across the list. And there will be a number of girls that come out of that youth girls program this year that will be of interest to all the clubs, I'd imagine.
Damien, it's enormously exciting for everyone, this whole process. And I just step forward for, say, a decade and just wonder where it's going to be then.
Well, you'd imagine that we're having footy shows that talk about female football just as much as male football, and that I think it can grow really quickly. We're going to attract players from other sports. We're going to have juniors and youth girls make footy their first sport. And that's going to happen really quickly when they see the product that we're going to put out early next year.
Nice work, Roz. Well done again. Damien, great. Good luck for next year. It's going to be absolutely exciting for Carlton.
Thanks, Nathan.
After the break, our local team of the week and live scores in the TAC Cup. That's next on Future Stars. Welcome back to Future Stars Big Show. It's now time for the Pride on the Line Team of the Week. Congratulations to this week's winner, the Cowar Football Club. They've won a $500 voucher to make sure his team recovers like the professionals with Pride on the Line. You can nominate your club every week to win the $500 voucher at our Facebook page. Recovery ice baths can help reduce fatigue, accelerate recovery, muscle repair and reduces inflammation. It's been a big show so far, Shifter. What's on for you for the rest of the day?
Well, I'm going to just put the feet up and relax after a week on the Gold Coast, and might cut the lawns tomorrow.
And just reruns of open mic for you?
No, my fourth live game for the weekend. Go and have a look at the Saints and the Bombers.
And Rancy, the best-looking man in the business?
Probably just brush the teeth, comb the hair, head out with the in-laws, you know, the usual ins and outs.
Thanks for joining us on Future Stars. We'll be back next week. May the sun shine on you today.